Hey everyone! Gosh, you haven't seen me since the last time. Today, I'm going to be looking at a Response Precision branded car audio amplifier. Model AA0424 is a 2x150 watt RMS amp, and I have not yet plugged it in. I don't know what the problem is. You didn't say specifically whether it didn't turn on or whether it just didn't make noise, so I shall firstly power it up. And see if we can figure out what's wrong with it. It's got a couple inputs on the side. What have we got there? No, one pair of RCA ins, possibly a little bent. One pair of RCA outs. Your sensitivity input, sensitivity control, bass level control, high or low pass filter control, and then your power speakers and fuses, which I should probably look at first. From this angle, they kind of look all right. Yeah, that one's gotten hot, but I don't think it's broken. that one just came off with left half the fuse inside the socket, as did that one. Let's grab some pliers and have a closer look at that. Oh, no, how about that? That actually broke. And I'm just having a closer look off camera, and it kind of looks like they have got hot. The fuse link, so to speak, looked slightly deformed. I'm just going to test before I pull this one out. Then I know if it breaks when I pull it out. Oh, yeah. Don't quite know how physically strong they are, but there we go. So this one actually did flex quite a bit, and it stayed intact in the process. Maybe the other ones were blowing. First off, the visual inspection, and on first glance everything looks okay. There's no signs of any sort of burning in the power supply area. You'd expect these switching transistors or FETs to usually blow, and they usually smoke up these resistors. There's really nothing obvious in that sense. So the next thing to do would be to find out what it does when we put power on it. Now I'm just going to do it. We've got meter on. Hear the beep for a short. We've got B plus here, should go through to our fuses, and that'll be the probably the underside connection. There we go. Fuse. So those fuses are all in parallel according to that, which means I can just stick our 12 volts straight onto any one of these and it should go through to the rest of it. Now I'll just do one quick measurement to ground. There we are. There's no short circuits on the input, which is a good sign. I think those fuses, I'm pretty sure they've just failed through use and weakness. We've got 300 k ohms on the input, which would be the input capacitors and such. Now I've limited the power supply to half an amp at 13 volts, and that will should be plenty to have this thing running idly anyway. Half an amp, there's really not much in that, so I'm just going to connect it now, and it's now sitting idly. We need to turn it on by connecting the that's our B plus, and that's our remote. Usually you get a 12 volt feed from the head unit. When that turns on, it feeds 12 volts into here so the amp can turn on, and your B plus is always connected. So we're going to join those two together now. And absolutely nothing is happening. There's no light coming up. So the power supply side of things, I think at this stage, is not functioning. In fact, not even a flicker on the bench supply of any current draw. There was a brief current draw when I plugged it in, but that would have been the input caps charging up. It's gone down to nothing now. Okay, what I've been doing at the moment is just going along and testing the transistors here, and there's two rows, one along each side, and I'm pretty sure these are FETs under here, and they work in tandem together to share the load while switching across the inductors. That one there, and there's one up further, and we've got 2, 4, 6. So whether they're working in sets of three per inductor, or whether they're working in parallel, all the six of them on each side. Not entirely sure yet, but once they switch the power across the inductor, we then have these two, and there's two on each side, and I haven't taken the heat sink off yet. But what I think they are is basically a bridge rectifier setup. It's two diodes in one package, and it converts the alternating pulses from the inductors out to DC. So as I say, I've been testing these FETs, gate, drain, and source, and making sure that they're not shorted together at all. And as you can see, because the resistor's not charcoal, it's a good sign. So and they're all measuring okay. So the next thing I did was take my meter and measure on diode check with I actually started positive on there and went negative and negative, and found that couple of them appear to be shorted together. If I try that again, what have we got there? The two outside ones appear to be shorted together, but I don't exactly know what's under the heat sink as far as the markings on the case, so that might be normal. But I will pull the heat sink off and we'll know for sure. Okay, so as I thought, they are a twin diode package. And we have, as you can see in the picture, and this one, two diodes head to head, and with the anode on each of the outer pins and the cathode at the center. So we have a pulse coming in the each outside pin and going out through the center, and then that travels off through to our capacitor set, and in this case as well, we have the anode in the center, with the cathodes on the outer, and again that takes the pulse through the center and out through the outside leads. Yeah, that gives us our positive and negative switching rectification. Now, in testing these, I'm using the diode check on the multimeter, or as Ben Heck says, the multimeter. I do disagree with that pronunciation because it sounds absolutely strange to me. But if you think of other meters like altimeter, you wouldn't say altimeter. Maybe someone does, I don't know. Each to their own. So we should be measuring from the outside, or the anode through to the cathode. And that's giving me a normal reading of about half a volt drop there, and from the outside to the center of that way is the same. And then if I measure the two outers, I'm getting what appears to be a dead short. Now, if you look at the circuit in a bit more detail, you'll find that that's actually okay. We have this trace coming up to this side of the inductor winding, and this trace coming up to the other side. So when measuring there and there, you're measuring across the inductor, so it should show up as a short circuit. when you're doing that. Now in this case we want to have positive there and negative on each of the outers, and that looks absolutely fine to me. Half a volt drop each side, and I'll just shoot up to the top of the board and just quickly check the ones up top there. And they are also as they should be. So that confirms that they're all right. I wasn't sure about that that low resistance across the outside there, but yeah, of course it's the inductor, so we don't need to worry about that at all. Next step, because the switching FETs appear to be okay as well, what we need to do is find out if the gate drive to the FETs is operational. And if I pan up here and just zoom out to give you a bit of context, this is the IC that drives the switching FETs. This is our input capacitance and storage for, I mean, this thing's putting out, what did I say it was, 150 watts or something. It needs a little bit of reserve. This is our secondary power supply capacitors. A lot more of them, they run at about 40 to 60 volts. But what we need to do is, yeah, find out if that is actually controlling the switching FETs, because at this stage it appears that nothing's happening there. That is solely by the fact that the light on the side of the unit doesn't come on. But also because there was a charge left on the input capacitors when I removed the power supply. But that might not be indicative of anything. What I need to do first is to make a voltage measurement and make sure that the power supply isn't running. So I'll need to be checking for voltage on this side of things, and go from there. Righty ho, here's our. I had to take the whole board out in order to do this, and double check exactly where the negative side of the secondary was. I wasn't 100% sure, but now I am, because it comes out of the inductors here and up here, and head on straight over to the negative of the speaker outputs, and the output transistors are just alternating the positive rail to ground. So we've got our, just to make sure, we've got our 12 volts coming in. Of which we have none. Why have we got none? I had power before. Right, wrong side of the fuse bank, silly man. Okay, there's our 12 volts, 13 volts, that's what we need to see. And on this side of the secondary side, we should have something. Now, definitely nothing going on there like I thought. Next thing to do would be to find out if we have any power on the switching transistor. Any power on the switching control IC. Now I've just moved that. Just make sure I've still got 12 volts there. I do, and I'll just take my ground reference. And we should have power on the remote on line. Now this is another path that I really should have covered to start with, because if the power is not going through the remote on side of things, then nothing's going to happen. So we can trace that through. We've got there's our remote control wire, which presently has nothing. I know exactly what I've done, and that was fairly stupid of me. I've gone and tried to power the remote wire from the positive side from the fused, the other side of the fuse. It's been a long day. So we think there's a fault with the output side of things, possibly because the protection light is coming on. So what we'll do is check the output transistors now. And we're going to be going from base to collector, base to emitter, and we can see our half volt drop. So that one's okay. And that one's okay. Collector, emitter, base collector, base emitter, collector, emitter. You always want to check the collector to emitter as well. They can go short circuit too. And that channel's all right. Just shoot up the top of the board here. Oh, that's not a good sign. That looks like a short to me. Base collector, base emitter, collector emitter. There we go. That one's shorted. That one's shorted. So is that one. So is that one. And so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. Looks like the entire side, the entire channel, whether it be left or right channel, I don't know exactly. One channel's completely destroyed itself. That's not too flash. All right. Next thing to do would be to find a source of these transistors, I guess, or equivalent of. What I'm also going to do is remove them from circuit, and the thing should power up and give us the green light once that's removed, and just to prove that the power supply is still okay, because of course we don't want to go throwing parts at it just to find something else is wrong with it. Okay, so now what I've done is unsoldered the two legs on each one. I've left the center one connected and just lifted them out of the board. And then we can go through and double check them out of circuit. And here's what I found. If we now these ones are NPN transistors, these three, and these three here are PNP transistors. And if you're ever confused as to what way the meter leads should be when checking them, if you think NPN with a P in the middle means positive on the base, and PNP with the N in the middle for negative on the base, and that's how you bias the transistor. So we've got base, collector, emitter, and that's how they're all of them are. And in this case, this is the NPN, so we've got positive on the base, and when we go collector, we see our half a volt drop across the junction, and emitter, we've got a half volt, and if we go collector emitter, that's open circuit as it should be. Now, if we check the next one along, we can see that base to collector is shorted, base to emitter is shorted, and collector emitter is shorted. So that one there is shorted, and I've done the same thing all the way along the end, and then we get to PNP ones. We've got half a volt there with our negative on the base. And then we get to the end one here, and that one's shorted. You can see it drops to zero on the meter. So so it's actually only blowing two of them, one on each side. And that was, because of the way they're connected, the shorted ones are making the others look like they were shorted when it was in circuit. So always a good idea to remove transistors from circuit if you suspect them as faulty, and test them out of circuit. Just to prove it, because I mean that it might be okay, there might be something else in the circuit across it that's posing a short, or there might be a resistor across it that makes it look like a short. So always good to pull them out of circuit. Now that we've done that, what I'll do is I'll turn on the power supply, and we'll have our, where's our LED, there's our LED, and it's my theory that the system should start and give us a green light and not draw a heap load of current like it was trying to do before. Well, yeah, green light. How about that? And it's now idling at 1 amp at 13 volts, which I'd expect as it's switching across the inductors. But yeah, some amps do that. They'll come on with a red light first, and then as the power supply gets up there, it'll go green. So I'll just do that again, just repeat that. Because the capacitors are charged, it may not take as long. So we've got red and green. There we go. And you can see the extra current draw kick in when the green comes on as well. So it's obviously some kind of, or maybe some kind of soft start in the power supply. Just stops speakers making horrible popping noises and things. So now that we know that there's only two transistors involved, it's certainly a more economical repair. Parts-wise, we're looking at about $30. And if he wants to flick anything my way, I'm always easygoing on that. This is fun for me, so I really don't expect payment other than the cost of the parts. I shall let him know and go from there. Right, I've been given the green light to spend that small amount on it, and I have the two parts, replacement parts here. They are not identical, but I believe they are enough to do the job, and I'll be putting the scope on it just to have a look at the output wave and make sure it's not distorted. Make sure there's not too much of a difference, otherwise I will have to go and find the exact same type. And yeah, so they are running in what looks like no, that yep, they are paralleled up for the power dissipation. So yeah, I guess there's two ways it could go. If it's switching on sooner, it will turn on harder sooner and draw more power through that one before the other two. And if it turns off sooner, then I guess the other two would carry a bit of the load before yeah, before they turn off, they'll be carrying a bit of the load on their own, so they might run a bit hotter. If I haven't mentioned it, the NPN transistor is a 2SD718, the PNP is a 2SB688, and what I've found that I think will do the job are MJL21194 and 21193. I've had a look at the data sheet, and there is some differences in the base drive on and off. Was it times or voltages? I think it was voltages. Like, we're talking microvolts to full off or whatever it was to full on. But yeah, we'll see how it goes. Right, I've got the replacement ones in, and they certainly dwarf the originals. I'm wondering if this will go back in its case. They are, yeah, as you can see, substantially taller and a bit wider, but the height is the real concern there. They still have exposed metal backing, so as far as heat sinking goes, that shouldn't be an issue. And they're the same thickness, so the clamping plates will be able to hold down the hold them down same the sound of the same pressure, so that should be all right. So now I'm going to turn it on, and we'll see what happens. We have our red light, and here goes our green light. Oh, and a bit. Here we go. Turn the current up, it didn't. Yes, my lovely power supply was current limited to half an amp, so that wasn't ideal. Yeah, anyway, let's try that again. Red light, green light, she draws out a bit of current, bit more than that supply can give. Actually, I should really have it on the bigger one, but for testing purposes, this will be fine. I've got it on full range frequency, and the sensitivity is probably somewhere in the upper area. It looks like 3/4 input level. So I don't have a signal generator. So what I do have is just got a very basic piece of software on the PC that can generate a sine wave. So let's pop it on the scope and see what's going on there. Righto. Now, I'm about to probe the input just to show you the signal there, and it will help if I turn it on, simply because it does have a bit of an amp in between, little op amps there. So there we are, and I believe it's about a kilohertz, but don't quote me on that. I think I've got the settings. I've only just got this little program now, so I haven't had a chance to look through the settings, but I think I saw something that said 1000 hertz there. Left channel, right channel, and if we then probe our output, we will get, if I can find, negative, positive, Right, there we have it. Horrible update rate on the camera there. Yeah, let's turn that up a bit. So there's our output wave, and I'm pretty confident that these transistors are working happily with the other one at this stage. There's no crossover distortion that I can see there. Where the waveform crosses over in the middle and goes the other way, there's no DC or zero period, rather. That doesn't look too bad at all. But what I do need to do is put a speaker on this and just make sure with a bit of load it stays good. And there we have the unit back in the case, and as you can see, it only just fits in the case. That's almost right up. I can get a fingernail in between there and the case, so that's okay. And there's definitely no of the none of the metal backing is touching the metal behind it. Still sitting on the sill pad for heat transfer. I think that will work just fine. Well, thoughts on why this might have failed? Perhaps there was a short on the speaker output at some point. Sometimes they just fail with age and stress and so on, and you know, because they get worked pretty well in these situations, and people crank them right up and so on. So yeah, I mean, if there was a short on the output, it may have taken out more than just those two, but hard to say, I guess. But the fix is good, and he'll be a very happy man. Very happy man. Catch you next time.